The former Met police officer Peter Bleksley is with us. I'm one of those who took part, Dr. Rupert Reid, a reader in philosophy at the University of East Anglia. Evening to you, Rupert.
Evening.
Evening, Rupert. You intend to stand as an MEP candidate for the Green Party in the upcoming European elections. And evening to you, Peter.
Good evening.
Hi, Peter. So, Rupert, you've been involved with Extinction Rebellion for some time. How can this action be justifiable?
Well, the answer to that is very simple. This is an emergency. If we don't get this sorted and fast, then we're done. The UN Secretary General says we've got 1 year to get our act together, so we've got a plan for how to reduce our emissions by half worldwide within the next decade. And of course, Britain has to reduce its emissions far, far more than that, because we're emitting way more than the average. So the situation is desperate, and desperate situations call for desperate measures. And that's why we're doing
this. Measures are basically blocking ordinary, decent people getting to work.
Well, I wouldn't put it quite as crudely as that. Actually, an awful lot of people...
You don't think that's what is happening?
Well, an awful lot of people are able to get to work just fine on the underground or whatever. But if we are blocking people from getting to work, then, of course, the reason why that's happening is so that we can draw drastic attention to the problem.
Yeah, but it's not if, Rupert. It's deliberate disruption, isn't it?
Of course it's deliberate disruption.
Right, so it's not an emergency. If you're stopping people getting to work. You're deliberately disrupting ordinary people's lives to bring attention to yourself.
Yes, but primarily what we're doing is we're trying to draw attention to this issue, which, as I've said, is an existential threat. Blaming us for messing things around here is like blaming the fire alarm that goes off in the middle of the night when your house is on fire for waking you up so you don't get a good night's sleep. You know, we are the alarm here. If that alarm is not heeded and rapidly, then there won't be any public transport, there won't be any work, there won't be any jobs on a dead planet. So I think that in the long run, people are going to thank us for the very strong level of attention that we've drawn to this. We wouldn't be having any of these discussions if it weren't for our rebellion. We'd just be talking more nonsense endlessly about Brexit.
Peter?
Well, clearly climate change is a very important issue. I'm certainly not a climate change denier. But what I am absolutely condemning is illegal protests, and I emphasise the word illegal, that took place in Oxford Circus. That's been cleared now, but there's certainly an illegal protest that continues in place on Waterloo Bridge, which, yes, causes disruption to people's everyday lives and to people during the working week, particularly last week.
And you need to disrupt to get attention, Peter. You know that.
And during the course of this illegal protest, hundreds upon hundreds of police officers who work for very stretched police services, whose budgets have been butchered, have been taken away from other far more important duties. What gives these protesters the right to behave illegally and to distract and draw police away from other important work?
You want me to answer that?
Well,
I'll answer it very happily. Yeah, well, the answer to the question is that if we don't do it, who will? And if it doesn't happen now, when's it going to happen? Let me repeat, we have 1 year to get our act together on this. This government has absolutely no plans at present to do so. They want to frack. They want to build a new runway at Heathrow. They're sending us in the wrong direction. They're sending us off a precipice. So we think that a bit of disruption to people's lives, yes, a bit of disruption to some people's journeys to work for a couple of weeks is a small price to pay. We are rebelling because a government cannot be legitimate that is condemning its own people, never mind the people of much of the rest of the planet and many non-human animals, to perdition. So that's why we're doing this, and we are very confident that history, if there is any history that even gets written, if we even manage to have a historian
it's
around
arrogance,
the future,
isn't it?
History will judge us to have been on the absolute right side of
but
the issue.
It's arrogance, Dr. Reid, isn't it? It's arrogance that you can decide and that your group can decide how and when you're going to disrupt other people's lives.
It
gives you the right to do that.
I've tried to explain
why
to you.
Why don't we disrupt your life?
Look, if you've got a really good cause, I'd be quite happy for you to disrupt my life. If you can show me that something is coming to kill me within a decade and you need to disrupt my life to stop it from killing me, I will be grateful to you.
But do you not believe
that's
in the rule of law? Illegal protests cannot be tolerated, can
we? We know that throughout history, progress has very often been made only through the use of illegal methods, as in the...
So you believe, so you're a reader in philosophy in a university, in the University of East Anglia, and you believe in breaking the law, do you?
I absolutely believe in breaking the law when the law is pushing us over a cliff.
So the students at your university should break all the university rules too, should they?
Well, they should break university rules if those university rules are putting us on the path to mass death.
That wasn't my question.
I don't think that... I just have answered your question with all due respect, sir. The university I do not think that I work in has rules that are condemning the whole society to self-destruction.
But you believe in criminality, do you?
I totally believe in breaking the law when the cause is just. Just like with Martin Luther King, just like with Gandhi, just like with the suffragettes. All of those people were judged at the time. They were told, oh, you're criminals, it's terrible what you're doing. And now we look upon them all as heroes. They've all got statues in Parliament Square. If we manage to have a future, if we manage to win this one, believe you me, there'll be statues of some of the Extinction Rebels in Parliament Square within the next 50 years.
Well, Peter, it's quite a powerful argument, is it not? They're not doing it for themselves. They're doing it in order to save the planet.
Yes, and as I've said earlier, of course, climate change is an issue. But this is no way to go about building a social movement.
Do you have a better idea, Peter? Are you an expert on social movements? Do you have a better idea as to how we can have success in turning our whole society around when it shows no signs of doing so?
I didn't think you were on this show to interrupt me when I was speaking.
Well, I've asked you a question.
Listen,
you want
hold
to
on,
it
hold
not?
On, Rupert. Hold on.
You don't ask the questions, Rupert.
Let Peter reply.
So you have no answer to my question. I'll take that as read.
I don't think you ask the questions on this show. I don't think it's your show.
You have no answer to my
all
question.
Right, now, you two, hold on, stop. Peter, you can address the point that I made to you, please. That what Rupert Reid and the other supporters of these protesters, there's no profit in it for them. They're not doing it for themselves. It's not selfish. They're doing it for the future generation and for the planet.
Yes, but there is a different way to go about building a social movement that doesn't involve breaking the law, lobbying one's MPs, creating a social movement.
We've been doing that for years.
Rupert, look, I can pull down your fader, mate, and then nobody can hear you, but I'm trying not to do that. So please just let Peter finish, Rupert.
You know, there are other causes which I support that are building movements for social change, particularly with regards to our laws on drugs, for example, where people are lobbied, MPs are lobbied and are coming on board in droves because they are spoken to properly, politely, approached, convinced of the arguments, and then they come on board.
And yet they haven't got the attention
the road,
that this has got.
Laying down in the road and gluing yourself to that road or to a metal pole or this, that and the other is lazy, not very well thought out, and remains illegal.
Lazy? What on earth are you talking about? What do you know about the effort involved in spending days camping on hard roads? You use the words like lazy, it's just lazy thinking yourself. And with all due respect, what do you know about building a successful social movement? Do you really think we haven't tried all those other methods? Do you really think we haven't tried emailing our MPs? Do you really think we haven't tried lobbying? We've been trying that for years. We've been trying that since I was a kid. And we're now out of time. So it's time to up the ante, and that's what we've done. And we've drawn huge, successful attention to the issue. We're getting massive positive feedback. We've got 900 heroic people who've put themselves forward to be willing to be arrested. There's nothing at all lazy about that.
Your definition of heroic and heroism is clearly very different to mine. The people who are heroic in my mind are cops who are out there on the streets trying to stem the tide of teenage blood that we have because of a knife crime epidemic, and yet so many of those officers have been drawn away from their work because of your protesters who choose to lay down in the road and disrupt everyday people's lives.
Look, you can play people off against each other if you want to. I can talk about the fact, for example, that police officers are needed in large numbers every time there's a football game. Do you think we should cancel all football games so they can all work on knife crime? It's a ridiculous argument. Let's talk about the real issue here, which is the vast scale of the suffering that is going to come unless Extinction Rebellion's demands are met. And all we're asking is for the government to negotiate with us. If the government agrees to negotiate with
us,
we will pause this rebellion right now.
Negotiate with who?
We would like to negotiate with members of the government, with Michael Gove, with whoever
is willing to negotiate with us. So who's the top negotiator?
Well, it would be the Extinction Rebellion team who are ready to do so.
But who are they?
Well, I can give you the names if you really want.
But who are they? Who appointed them?
Well, it's they're selected by people from within Extinction Rebellion.
So they're self-appointed?
The movement is open to anybody. You can join us yourself if you wish to, sir.
Sure, but they're self-appointed.
Well, like, absolutely. What else would you like me to do?
And who decided who was going to be at the head of this organisation? How did that happen?
Well, we're an organisation. organization that has various kinds of internal methods for organization, which are all available for view on our website.
Was there a democratic vote?
Well, it's a complicated procedure. We do a lot of things by consensus.
But was there a vote within the organization as to who would lead it?
No, that's not how we proceed.
So by gluing yourselves to footpaths and disrupting people's lives, now you say all you want is for these self-appointed people. We don't know how they got there. We don't know the democratic process within that organization that led them there. And you want them to have a free, open door to the government.
What we want to do is to negotiate some kind of solution to the little impasse we have in London right now, and much more importantly, we want to negotiate about our demands. And our demands, of all due respect, sir, our demands are for the good of everybody. Once again,
how do we know, Rupert? Sorry, let me challenge you on that.
Well, all right. Let me
put the question to you first. Hold on, 1 second. I want to give you time to explain this to me.
Yeah.
So for those people who do care about climate change and do actually care about what you're fighting for,
mm-hmm.
But you're telling them that you're now going to negotiate on their behalf with the government.
And on behalf of future generations, on behalf of our children who are not able to vote.
Hold on a moment. You've been given no mandate by the British public
to do
that.
So what are you asking us to do? Just go through the regular democratic process, which has completely failed?
But I'm trying to challenge you in that when you say that you want the government to meet your demands, those demands have not been tested through a democratic process. Who knows what those demands are?
Well,
who
shall knows I tell about you what the, they are?
Hold on
a moment.
Who knows about the competency of those people?
Shall I tell you what the demands are?
Those people negotiate. And who died and gave the power, the ultimate power, to these people at the top of this self-appointed organisation to be able to walk in and negotiate with the government and have a list of demands?
Are you going to let me speak? Let me speak. Shall I tell you what the demands are? The demands are, number one, tell the truth. Tell the truth about how extreme the crisis is. Number two, Britain carbon neutral by 2025. Anything less is putting us on the road to catastrophe. Number three, citizens' assembly so that all the people, and not just us, can decide how we get there. Now, I challenge anybody to say what's wrong with those demands.
Well, I think there's some very sound scientific evidence that says, with regards to the carbon neutral demand, it's simply not achievable.
No, that's not true. It is achievable, it's just very, very demanding. And many scientists have said that. They said they don't think it's politically realistic, but that's not the same thing as unachievable. It's perfectly achievable.
And
how we have the will.
And how exactly would you set out to achieve that?
I'm glad you asked that, and the answer is that will be decided by the citizens' assemblies. Our democratic system, representative democracy, has failed us. What we want to do is supplement it with citizens' assemblies.
You must have you've clearly looked at this yourself, Rupert.
Mm-hmm.
So to do it by 2025, what's your view on how it could be achieved? What would need to happen?
Okay, yeah, so there's various things that are clearly kind of on the cards. So to start us, one would need to roll back all the ridiculous things we're thinking of doing, like building HS2, like a new runway at Heathrow, like fracking, like a load of new road projects that are on the cards. Take out all of that for starters.
Stop all new road projects.
Pretty much, yeah. Next, you'd need to take a bunch of fossil fuel polluting power stations and bioenergy power stations offline, obviously moving to replace those as quickly as possible, wherever possible.
Well, take them offline by when?
Energy. What's that?
Take them offline by when?
Well, certainly by 2025.
But if you took them offline by 2025, you're not going to be carbon neutral by 2025.
Well, then we get on to the next parts of the thing, which would be presumably you'll be looking to have some means to absorb some carbon from the atmosphere. The best way of doing that is, in my opinion, by reforestation, rewilding. But look, I'm not going to give too much details on this because, as I say, the beauty of the Extinction Rebellion demands is that we're not actually laying out a detailed program. We're
not laying out
a manifesto. No, well, no, we're actually not.
One of your demands is for us to be carbon neutral by 2025.
That's the one demand that is concrete.
The strategy of achieving that has been thought through.
Well, on the contrary, what we've done is we thought, where do we actually need to get to, right? Where do we actually need to get to such that we would achieve safety? And then the idea is the backcast from there.
Okay. And all of these power stations that you're closing down, they're being replaced by what, sorry?
Well, as I said, they would hopefully be replaced by renewable energy.
And how long would that take, to build that infrastructure? How long would that take?
Well, it would couple of years.
How many years?
I can't tell you precisely, can
but
I?
But you've got the precise date of 2025.
Yes, because the point is that that's the date.
So this is 2019.
Yes.
So when would the building have to start for the renewable projects to replace the power stations that you want to close down?
Ideally, it would start yesterday, but as we
can't start
yesterday.
This. You need to be real about this, Rupert. If you want to be respected, surely you need to be real
about
this.
But I think you're missing the point, with all due respect, sir. The point is that we're not laying out a manifesto. We are not a political party. What we are saying is,
you're demanding that the government accede to your demands.
You keep on interrupting me.
I keep interrupting you because it's my right to, when you do not answer the question.
You don't let me lay out the case.
But I'm asking, hold on a minute. Let me tell you the case I'm asking you to lay out. Rupert, it's not for you're not saying to the British people they can decide, because you haven't asked the British people for their permission for you to disrupt their lives. And you're saying that the only time that you will now stop is when the government accedes to your demands.
No, we want to negotiate. We're not saying that.
Okay, but when you walk in as credible negotiators, when you walk in that door, surely your demands need to be realistic. So when you're talking to a government minister and you say to that government minister, we want all of these power stations closed down by 2025, and the minister says, and replaced by what? And you lot say, well, by renewable energy, but we don't know how much it's going to cost. We don't have a time plan laid out.
You're
we don't know how long it's going to take
the
bill. And we want it done yesterday. Is that credible?
You haven't got it, partly because you haven't let me finish answering your questions and you've asked them. The point that we're saying is we need citizens' assemblies to decide this. We need the people. We need the wisdom of the people, informed by the best experts, to make these decisions, because the government has failed to do so.
So you lot don't know.
We're not laying out a plan. We're not arrogant enough. You seem to think we're very arrogant. We're not arrogant enough to think we have all the answers. What we do know is that we must attain carbon neutrality by something like 2025.
Not something like 2025. You said earlier 2025.
Well, that's our demand, but we're willing to negotiate even on that. We're willing to be flexible.
But you've no plan.
What we're saying is it's for the British people, together with experts, to come up with a plan. It's not for us to say, here's our detailed plan. What we all need to be clear on, is that unless we get our act together to rapidly reduce carbon, much, much more rapidly than the government has pledged to, and by the way, it's on target to completely miss its pledges, then we're going to be up SHAT Creek without a paddle. Right? So it's about how we get to the place where we need to get to, and how we sort out a method together for doing that. And we believe that the British people can do that together.
Let me bring in Dr. Jennifer Rudd as well, who's a scientist and chemistry researcher. Hello, Jennifer.
Hi.
Hi. You've taken part in previous demonstrations. Go ahead, Jennifer. Thanks for coming on.
Where am I going to start? So you said that there's no plan, and I think there's a lot laid out in the IPCC report about what a number of different countries can do in order to decrease their carbon footprints and become carbon neutral rapidly. You talked about renewables and how quickly can we make those, and if you think about in World War II, we didn't know what we were capable of before we started the war, and by the end, we'd surpassed all expectations. With technology, the technology is there. We just need to roll it out. People ready and waiting. There was a conference last week on carbon capture, and there are companies and there are academics who are ready and waiting to roll out groundbreaking technology that will help us in the fight against climate change. The only thing that they are waiting for is the government to move. And we have numerous stories about time and time again where different governments around Europe had stopped carbon capture projects from going ahead. Now, Holland could have been, the world leader in carbon capture back in 2009. They were ahead of the game, and successive governments stopped it. And in BASE, in the Business and Engagement Innovation Department of the government, they used to have 40 people working on carbon capture. And then it got cut down to 3 with a different government. And now it's back up to 15. Now carbon capture is back on the table. Dr. Reid was talking about being able to absorb carbon dioxide out of the air. That's something that we can, the Swiss can already do that. We can capture it from what are called point sources, so cement factories, steel industry. We could capture that carbon dioxide. All we're waiting for is the go-ahead.
I guess the point I'm trying to make tonight, Jennifer, is that when Dr. Reed says it's not for us to have a plan, it's up to the British people to have a plan, does that really sound like a movement that will be respected by the British people?
That
your group is saying you have a list of demands, but when I actually try to probe, well, how much depth and how much thinking is there behind those demands, Dr. Reed's response is, well, we're going to hand that over to the British people. It's circular, is it not?
Can I respond to that? Just to say one thing on that, is that I think you're putting us in an unfair dilemma, because on the one hand you start out saying you're arrogant, and as soon as we try to say, no, we're not arrogant, we're letting the British people actually decide how we do it, then you say, oh, well, you're giving up, you've got no ideas or something, so we can't win either way, can we, really? It's not very fair.
I don't think they necessarily, you know, Extinction Rebellion is made up of an entire cross-section of society. You know, they don't just have you know, people who have been climate activists for a long time. They've got people new to the court. They've got people with university degrees. They've got people with PhDs. They've got scientists. They've got philosophers. You know, they've got sociologists. And what can do is go back to their base, go back to the expertise within their base and say, okay, you have this set of knowledge that we need. Can you come to the fore at this point? And that's what I really like about Extinction Rebellion, that actually, you know, people are treated equally. When you go into a meeting, everybody has something to bring, and that is respected. And so, on the one hand, you know, XR, if they get to negotiate, will go back to the scientists and they will talk to them. They'll say, what's the cutting edge research? What can we bring to the government? The other thing is that people have already done this work. The government can look very easily and find what needs to be done.
So why do you think they're not doing it, Jennifer? Why do you think the government hasn't done it up to now?
I think governments, they don't like making decisions. They don't like making decisions that take them beyond an election cycle. And particularly in the political climate that we've got at the moment, where everybody is up against each other, and even, you know, we've seen the Conservative Party rip themselves apart, it's very, very difficult for them to think beyond where they are right now and beyond re-election. And I think that's a real problem. And I think this is where the Citizens Assembly comes in, because the Citizens Assembly, they don't mind being re-elected.
Well, listen, Dr. Reed, you might not believe this, but I've really enjoyed talking to you tonight. Thank you very much. Jennifer Rudd, thank you. Here's the number to